Good morning, and welcome to Walton United Church virtual service. No need to worry, there's nothing wrong with your monitor or your computer. But we did want to start the service this way. We wanted to talk about, this morning, the light of Jesus. How Jesus came down into the world on Christmas and shone on each one of us.
Scripture tells us that this light will not be overcome by any darkness. It is a great gift, the white light of Christmas.
Come, let us worship.
As we gather together this morning, we are excited, a little scared, and a little apprehensive, as we call this the last day of summer usually. But with the school start up being pushed back a week, I guess that doesn't really matter. You know what? It's still the end of summer. You can tell by the coolness in the evening, the frosting of orange on the tips of the treetops. I think that means summer's coming to a close. We usually look forward to this Sunday, as this is usually startup week. A return to routine, new classes, new experiences, groups and clubs starting up again, joining together in church. So after a summer where we haven't been together. Unfortunately, this year, that's not possible. So
we gather virtually today, in spirit, with gratitude for our safety and our health, and with excitement, where two or three are gathered in my name. We reunite with the spirit to worship and to do God's work in our world. Let us worship God together.
Let us pray. Lord, we come to you this morning with so many mixed emotions, with it being Labor Day, and what would be the end of the season summer, a time of rest and restoration, and the start of a new school year. Please help us, Lord, to be patient, to be caring, to be not afraid of choices we have made for our children. Help us to pray for those whose choices we struggle with. Help us not to judge or condemn, as only you know what challenges they face each day in their lives. Help us to be supportive, loving, caring, and not judgmental.
We ask you, Lord, to be with our teachers, who are in the middle between government officials, unions, parents, and children. We thank you for those teachers who have been called to do this work. We ask you to bless them as they prepare for this new year. Please give them strength to lead, grace to guide them, and wisdom and hope to thrive in their classrooms and schools. We ask you to keep the teachers and the children safe and healthy.
We pray for our children, Lord. Please give them the gratitude in knowing that they are blessed to have an education. Give them courage and strength, confidence as their foundation, grace as their guide, and hope in learning and growing in and through their education. Although it might be different from their usual school experiences and their usual companions in school, help them to adjust to the changes and not to be afraid of experiencing a new way of learning, both in the classroom and virtually. Help the children to remember that they are not alone. You, Lord, walk alongside them in everything they do.
As we come to you this morning, Lord, we ask for your peace and light and focus on you. We seek your peace. We look to your light and love as we gather for worship wherever we are. Remind us of your promise to us that you will provide. When hope wavers, when our faith seems insufficient, when our strength falls short, we trust in your promise that you will provide. Lead us and teach us to lean on you in all things. Amen.
kingdom come, thy will be done, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us.
This morning's story is taken from a story you may have heard at Christmas time. Just the words have been changed a little bit. We're going to call it, "'Twas the Night Before School." "'Twas the night before school went all through the house. Not a creature was stirring except for this spouse. Schoolbag sat by the front door with care. She had bathed the kids and blow-dried their hair. Lunches were made and shoes had been shined. I hope they don't catch it, raced through her mind. The children were sleeping fast in their beds with dreams of reunions with all their friends. Where classes are bubbles and tables are pods, there's safety in the hands of the government. When down in the kitchen arose such a clatter, husband ran down to see what was the matter. Away to the kitchen he flew like a light. His wife sat crying at the table. He knew something was not right. I want them to go, but I want them to stay. I want this terrible virus to just go away. For the first time in months, her bubble had burst. She thought she'd feel happier, but now she feels worse. The what-ifs were racing around in her mind, and her husband hugged her and tried to be kind. We've waited for this day for schools to reopen, but the mixture of change and fear had her quite frozen. She feigned a smile and sipped on her tea and persuaded herself, I'll have more time for me. But 6 months has passed, the country none the wiser. School bags now packed with masks and hand sanitizer. But this is a good thing for schools to reopen. The children deserve it. It's what they've been hoping. Children of Ireland have shown such resilience, positive attitude, and absolute brilliance. You might feel nervous or perhaps feel okay to release your babies back to school today. But whatever you feel, no, it's not forever. We'll get through this, and we'll get through it together. This was written by Aoife Driver on August the 27th. Let us pray together. Loving God, we ask for your protection on each of your children, but we ask for your protection on the blessing you have given us, our children, as they head back to school. Help us to teach our children the best we can to wear masks, to keep their distance, sanitize their hands, and protect each other. Help us to trust that you are watching over and placing a teacher or teachers to care for and guide our kids to be safe, just like we would. As you trust your children to us, we trust our children to others, as it does take a village to raise a child. Lord, please keep us safe and healthy. This is my prayer today. Amen.
Our scripture readings this morning are taken from Mark 16, verses 1 to 7, and Matthew chapter 18, verses 15 to 20, and I'm reading from the New International Version. Jesus has risen. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him? But go, tell his disciples and Peter. He is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." And our reading from Matthew, dealing with sin in the church. If your brother or sister sins, go and point out their fault, just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you have won them over. But if they will not listen, take one or two others along, so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If they still refuse to listen, tell it to the church. And if they refuse to listen even to the church, treat them as you would a pagan or a tax collector. Truly, I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by the Father in heaven. For where two or three gather in my name, there I am with them. Here ends the reading of God's holy word.
Thank you.
Do you know that old adage, do not wear white after Labor Day? As both the magazines, Marie Claire and Time, have pointed out, wearing white in summer months may have been a way for those who are ultra rich to self-identify as separate from the working classes or even the nouveau riche. In short, if you lived in the big dirty city, you wore dark clothes. If you were wealthy enough to escape to a vacation home in the summer in places like the Toronto Island or Bronte or Lake Muskoka, you wore white leisure looks until it was time to return to the urban life, that is, after Labor Day. Well, it is Labor Day Sunday, and I'm both wearing white, and I'm going to be talking about the color of white today. But I did not escape for the summer to a vacation home on a steamship like the Seguin out of the Gravenhurst dock, having ridden up by train from Toronto, wearing white clothes. I was, however, in an air-conditioned church office most of the summer, while those coming and going who were working on the Walton Commercial Kitchen did that huge upgrade. Today is the last of my series of messages on the colors of the Bible, which I began a few months ago. White biblically refers to holiness, light, purity, redemption, and the righteousness of Jesus. Jesus is often portrayed in art as wearing white garments, or he has a white countenance around him in some way. We see it in paintings and sculpture and mosaics and tapestries, both ancient and modern. White, we are told, is an uplifting color, which is defined in terms of purity, light, goodness, heaven, safety, illumination, understanding, cleanliness, faith, beginnings, possibilities, humility, sincerity, protection, softness, and even perfection. Think of the white sheets of a hospital bed, or the white gown at a wedding, or the white tablecloths at a fancy restaurant. In movies, the color white is typically worn by a good character in a plot. People who've had near-death experiences talk about moving towards the light. One of our readings today is the Easter account from the Gospel of Matthew. Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, note the white light here in this description, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll away the stone from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe. The angel is always in white, whether it's a Christmas Eve nativity play or the Easter story. They saw the angel in white sitting on the right side, and they were so alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," said the angel. "You're looking for Jesus, the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen." The angel in white delivers the greatest news of all time. Death has been defeated. Jesus is risen. Hallelujah. We are an Easter people. We are a people of the light, of the empty tomb, and the risen Lord Jesus Christ. Our Jesus is not still in the darkness of the 3 p.m. Good Friday crucifixion. For us, Sunday is always coming. No matter how dark Friday may be, Sunday is always coming. Let us remember that in these days of the darkness of uncertainty, that there is always the light of Christ, the Easter Sunday light. Our text reminds us, "For where two or three gather in my name, there I am also." The color of snow, white, is often used to represent coolness and simplicity. Some of the most incredible photographs of Jerusalem I've ever seen are those taken on the rare years when it snows on the holy city. And the lens of the camera captures that rare whiteness. Have you ever seen a full moon rising on a clear night over Lake Ontario here in front of the Walton Church? What a blessing of white beauty. I think too of the wise men following the white star that lit the way to Bethlehem so that they could worship the Christ child and present their gifts. The color white's association with cleanliness and sterile conditions is often seen in hospitals, medical centers, laboratories, and it communicates a sense of safety, even more so in these COVID days. I was thinking of that the other day while using the white Lysol wipes to disinfect the Walton washroom sink. The angels in white told us about Jesus, who can help us wipe away those things in our past and in our present that are making us sick, both literally and figuratively. That is what a prayer of confession is about. We can confess, we can repent, we can have our direction totally changed by faith. We can start again walking in the steps of Jesus. It is never too late. Our other Bible reading today talks about how to resolve conflicts in a biblical way, not by putting all the problems out all over social media, but resolve them privately, in person. Jesus says we are trying to resolve our issues, not in a public way, but in a one-to-one way with another believer. Too often, it seems people discuss their conflicts with everyone except the person that they need to talk to. And it makes a real difference when we go and talk to that person. That's where resolving conflicts begin. To the human eye, white is bright, and it's a brilliant color that can cause headaches when it's in abundance. Like the person who does not dim their high beams as they get near you, driving on a country road. In cases of extreme white light, the color white can blind you, for example, getting too close to a searchlight and looking at it. But conflicts can also blind us. We think that we are so much in the right, so much in the white light, due to pride, stubbornness, or fear, we can't admit that we may not be as pure as we think we are in this or that situation. Jesus says, work it out. Go and talk to this person or that person. Sort it out. Work on it. One author writes that the color white affects the mind and body by aiding in mental clarity, promoting feelings of fresh beginnings and renewal, assisting in cleansing, clearing obstacles and clutter, and encouraging the purification of our thoughts and our actions. Think of that expression, turning the page on something. This year's school startup is like none other we have ever known. Our prayers are with the students, the parents, the teachers, the administrators, the families. Whether the children are learning at home, working in pods, learning online, or are back in redefined classrooms. It is a new page, a blank page, a fresh start after not having been in school since March break. I don't know about you, but it seems to me that this is the greatest challenge our society is currently facing in these COVID days. There are no easy or quick answers. May the light of God guide all of us in this situation. May the light of God give us wisdom. May the light of God keep us safe. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, help me to rise to the light of today. Help me to shine forth and let your glory radiate over me, that others will see you working in me and through me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. If I've been ignoring your calling, I'm sorry. Please help me to see your plan for me, to be that beacon of light, to rise and shine now, today. Help me to shine your light in the darkness of fear and uncertainty in my job, education, business, family, and relationships. Create in me a clean heart. Help your light to shine through my addictions, my worries, my fears, my loneliness, my grief, my anger, and my longing for normal. Help me to focus on you and your promises, your love for me and each one of your children, no matter our age or stage of life. That helping one another, living out your promises and loving one another, shines your light in each of our darknesses. We lift all these challenges to you, Lord, and ask for your help as we travel this road of life together through this pandemic time. Create in me a clean heart. We pray for our government leaders, our medical doctors, nurses, and staff, our educational leaders, teachers, and custodians, our religious leaders, and all those who have someone they are looking after or have someone looking after them. Each person, Lord, needs you now more than ever. We ask for your love and light to guide us and protect us. Create in us a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O Lord. Spirit within me, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me.
We sometimes think of our offering as a sacrifice, and it is. But more to the point, we often think of a sacrifice as negative. Yet we don't see sacrifice as negative when we are thinking of the sacrifices of athletes to practice, or when we get off Facebook to do our homework, or help our children with their homework, or when we sacrifice a previous lifestyle to have children in the first place. Mm-hmm. When Jesus calls us to be disciples, He's calling us to sacrifice. But no one benefits from our discipleship more than we do. A sacrifice can be a positive investment with a purpose, even for those who have sacrificed their lives, like Jesus did. So yes, our offering is sacrifice. It is also discipleship. It is an investment, and it benefits us all. We now give our offering.
Let us pray. Loving God, accept these gifts as thanksgiving for your many blessings. Accept these gifts as our commitment to your kingdom. Accept these gifts and accept our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God in Jesus calls you, even above the roar of the storm, the fear of the unknown, and the making of the wrong choice. I invite you, as you walk into the new week, reach out to your neighbor, do justice, love kindness, and together walk humbly with your God. Amen.